Hello friends, I welcome you all. Today we will discuss about the mechanism of the fold. Okay, so based on the fold mechanism, we can divide the process of the mechanism into three categories: buckle fold, bending fold and passive fold. This classification is available in the old books. As we know, Ramsey classification, in Ramsey book you will get this classification, is Ramsey 1967, and SK Ghosh book also. But in recent literature you will get the mechanism of the fold as flexure fold and shear fold. So we will discuss one by one. First one is buckle fold. So buckle folds result from an instability when a layer or a stack of layer is subjected to a layer parallel compression. As we can see in this figure, if we apply a force from this direction and this direction, it will bend like this. Okay, so in buckle fold, in flexure fold or buckle fold, fold form when the force apply parallel to the layer. A contrast in competence among the associated layer is essential for the buckling. The presence of the layer of contrasting competence produce a mechanical anisotropy. Buckle fold can also develop in a cleave rope which has planar anisotropic in the form of cleavage but no distinct layering. So when buckle fold is also formed in the cleave rope also. So buckling result from the application of compressive stress parallel to the layer. If the compressive stress parallel to the layer is sufficiently large, the layer become unstable and buckles into a fold, either under compressive stress alone or in association with additional torque. So buckle forms like this. And flexure folding, buckle is also the significance of buckle fold. The buckle fold is also very important in thrust belt, in which the compressive stress that drive the thrusting causes the layer to the buckle, as we can say in Himalayan region. So buckle folds also very important in the Himalayan region too. Then flexure folding, the model of flexure folding, or we can say the geometry of flexure folds may be explained, or this model may be explained by orthogonal flexure, flexure shear and volume loss flexure, collectively known as flexure folding. Okay, in all three models, the orthogonal thickness of the layer remain constant during the folding, thereby producing class 1B fold, as we can see in the Ramsey classification, class 1B type of fold produced due to flexure folding. The layer remains in flexure folding, the layer remains constant during folding, thereby producing class 1 fold. Flexure folds may be bending, where a vertical force act below a layer to lift it into a fold like this. Here the force is acting vertically and this bending type of fold is forming here. So this flexure folding is also important to know, the flexure folding. So then geometry of single layer buckle folds, as we can see the single layer buckle folds. So this single layer folds fold in natural rocks are generally observed in quartz or calcite veins. Calcite veins occurring in palitic rocks or pegmatitic and apatitic veins in granitic terrain. The tight or isoclinal fold in the veins are described as stigmatic structures. The arc length of the fold increase with increasing competence contrast as well as with increasing thickness of the vein. For the same pair of rock, the ratio of arc length to thickness remain approximately same. Single layer fold show a small range of the shape. In single layer fold, the arc length will be the very small, but when we talk about the multi-layer folds, the arc length will be the high. So chair one type of fold and conjugate fold do not normally develop by buckling of single layer. Single layer folds belong either 1B class or 1C class in Ramsey fold classification. Buckle and flexure folding of multi-layers. Flexure shear folding, similar to the bending of a deck of a card, just like we play the playing cards. So if we fold the playing cards, then the movement such type of movement that occurred in the playing cards is resembled to the flexure type of folding. As we can see here, these are the multi layers in natural rocks. If we naturally bend these rocks, they will slip like this. This layer move towards the upward direction and this one is downward direction, so they behave like a playing cards. So motion is parallel to the shear planes. As we can see, the motion always take place along these shear planes. These are the shear planes. Along this plane, this block is moving toward this direction and this one this. So all the layers act as a shear plane in multi-layer folding type of mechanism. Then buckle and flexure folding of multi-layers. There are several factors. Those affect the multi-layer folds. First one, thickness of the competent layers. The multi-layer folds also depend on the thickness. If the bedding or the thickness of the layers is less, they can generate the Chevron type of fold also. If the thickness is high, they can move towards the class 1A or class 3 type of fold. Then spacing between the competent layers, it also depends the spacing between the competent and incompetent layers. Competence contrast among the layers, yes, it is true that competency contrast also affect the type of the folding. For example, we can take the example, if suppose that we have alternate layering of slate and quartzite in any region, then we can see the formation of the parasitic fold. So we have alternate incompetent and competent layering. That's why we are getting parasitic types of phenomena in the low contrast layering as preserved in the slate type of rock. Competence of the medium confining and the multi-layers also. And when multi-layer, both in nature and in model experiment, may show round hinge fold like Chevron fold, kink bands and conjugate folds. When smoothly curved single hinge fold develop in a multi-layer composed of alternate competent, incompetent unit, the competent unit show either 1B or class 1C fold geometry. When in the incompetent unit, the fold show class 3 geometry. So this is the scenario of the multi-layer of folding in the nature. Then cases of buckling folding. First one, if suppose that we have weak confinement. So in weak confinement, arc length much larger than the total thickness. If suppose that we have very weak confinement, means stress will be less, the arc length will be high comparatively to the thickness of the beds. The roundness of the fold hinge is generally retained even when the fold become tight or isoclinal. In the weak confinement, the roundness of the hinge will be higher comparatively high confinement stress regime or area. Strong or moderately strong confinement. When we move from weak confinement to strong or moderately strong environment, the thick length of the arc will be reduced, okay, and the total thickness will be higher. So with the arc length smaller than the total thickness, as we have stated earlier, with progressive tightening, the fold in the central zone of the multilayer become chevron like with long state. So means the confinement increasing, the hinge portion converting in the chevron types of fold. So this is the case where the confinement increasing, so the geometry of the fold is means converting from roundness to chevron type of sharp hinge type of fold. Then small competence contrast or restricted case of gliding in multi layers means competency contrast is very small and movement is also very less. Then weak confinement, under this layer parallel shortening, the multi-layer develop conjugate types of fold. In such type of case, we get conjugate type of fold. Then the initial wavelength of the conjugate fold being larger than the total thickness of the multi-layer. This is the case in the weak confinement. Then if we move towards the moderately and weak confinement, the underlayer parallel shortening, the multi-layer develop small kink bands. Means when we move towards the increasing confinement, the multi-layered confinements become more and more. That's why we are getting kinks types of fold in the region. Then drag folds or parasitic folds. As we know, drag folds and parasitic folds is developed due to flexure flow, and we have high density contrast too. So due to alternate hard rock, soft rock, hard rock and soft rock, when hard rock move against the soft rock will show high zigzag structures, and these zigzag structure preserve in the soft sediments, and the hard rock drag this soft sediment against the movement, and this process comes under the flexure flow type of movement. So due to this movement we are get parasitic type of fold. So in parasitic type of fold become asymmetrical with opposite sense of symmetry, and we get jet type of structure at the left limb of the antiformal structure, and S type of structure at the right limb of the antiformal structure, and symmetrical M type of structure in the center. And we can say, if suppose that this situation is changed towards the synclinal structure, we get Z type of a structure at the right limb, S type of a structure at the left limb, and W symmetrical structure in the center portion. Then diagnostic morphological characteristic of the buccal folds. In single layer fold, the lithology and the arc length thickness ratio is more or less constant. Buckling of certain types of multilayer give rise to disharmonic or polyharmonic folds or a regular train of the parasitic fold with opposite sense of symmetry in low limbs, as we can see the example in the natural photographs. Then bending folds. Bending fold develop in response to force acting across the layer. These folds are much less common than buccal folds. Okay, the most common type of bending folds found in the mesoscopic scale, as those which develop near the separation zone of the bodines. The bending fold associated with bodinage structure rapidly die out as move away from the bodinage layers. Okay, so as we can say, we can take the example salt dome, granite dome. So such type of structure develop in salt dome like of associated region and the granite dome too. Then pursue shearing folding of a layer. Pursue folds are produced by attenuation of pre-existing curvature of layer by more or less homogeneous strain. Okay, so in pursue folding, which is also called pursue flow folding or simple flow folding, the layer is highly incompetent and exert in influence on the process of folding. This process result in class 2 or similar type of fold in the nature. The shear plane can be oriented at any known zero angle to the layer, and the shear direction within these planes can be any orientation except parallel to the layer bending. This type of fold are very common in high grade metamorphic rock. What happen in such type of fold when layer parallel to each other? Here in the hinge portion we get some voids due to flexure shearing. What happened? Because there is high density contrast, we will get some voids, and these voids fills by secondary melting material that's produced due to the movement of these layers. That's why hinge get thicker and the limb get thinner in this process. As we can see here, this is a diagram, we can see competency contrast and the mean competency contrast. When the mean competency contrast become high, we get flexure slip type of mechanism. And when we move towards the competency contrast in the intermediate, we get flexures here. In passive shearing, we can see the mean competency contrast is very low, but competency contrast increase from low to high. Stigmatic type of fold occur at the high competency contrast and intermediate mean competency contrast. As sliding of the layer past one another commonly result in the development of the linear striation. We can see here we have multi-layers type of the fold and region in the region, and when we bend these, compress these rocks, we get multi-layer sliding to each other. So we get flexure slip movement along these layers, and this form a multi-layer types of fold, and due to this process we get class 1b type of the fold. So I hope you have enjoyed this video a lot. Thank you very much, and I hope you will give your feedback Thank you.